Shaka. Okay, so let's go.
This is what you move. It's not a much value to also.
I can put it as a review if you want. Yeah, you can watch. If you accept, I can post at YouTube to review another time. Okay. So let's go. So as I told you, we are going to start with syntax, a specific kind of syntax, generative syntax. But before we study syntax in a deep way, we are going to understand what is generativism theory. What is that? Who were responsible for that? Or who was responsible for that? Okay? Here were the symbols that I told you, yes. At, it's important when you have to communicate your email. Sometimes in your work you will receive a client, a foreign, a tourist, an American, English, British person. Sometimes you have to fill a form, okay? And it's important to ask, oh, what's your email address? And sometimes a person says, but you don't understand. And you have to say, spell it, letter by letter. And people say, okay? @ hyphen is in the middle, okay? It's different of underscore, okay? It's something like that. @ underscore, okay? It's different deposition. We call it Brazil underline. It's another name, underscore, okay? Dot. And we have different ways to, different shapes to write. In a big size, we call in capital case, minuscules, or in lower case. In Brazil, usually we use the email address in always in lower case. But in other countries, it's common to make a mix. Sometimes people start in capital, and after, lower. We saw dot, capital, and so on. It's very common to make a mixture in other countries. In Brazil, the pattern is in lower case, but sometimes it could be possible to use in capital. Another thing, our class would be 100% in English. Our class would be 100% in English. So, don't be worried. Don't be worried, okay? If you have some difficulty to understand English, we are going to have some material to support it, so you have to study at home, okay? The material is very good, it's very simple. I'm going to put all the examples with the pictures. She knows my class. Yeah, I like to use pictures, some videos to give some examples. It's easier. It's easier to understand. Okay?
What is the flower?
Flower, yes. Capital, capitular, letras capitulares, letras maiúsculas. Flower, minúsculo. Pequeno, okay? Flower. Em letra maiúscula e em letra minúscula. Em capital, você pode dizer só em capital ou só em lower também. Não precisa dizer case. É como se a gente dissesse caixa alta. Em caixa alta, em caixa baixa. A gente usa muito quando está escrevendo no TCC e na monografia. Ok? So, it's just one curiosity, but let's see the subject. Do you know who is this guy? You have a clue here.
Noam Chomsky
is a very important person in our century. Okay, Noam Chomsky was the guy, the man responsible to elaborate a very, very big and interesting theory called generativism. Okay? And this theory tells us that to acquire a language, it's a simple process. Actually, it's a biological process. When we were a baby, when we was born, we have in our minds one capacity, one ability to observe language. Okay? We have only to have some contact with the exterior to activate this device, okay, this equipment. So, if you have a baby, and your baby have some contact with one American, one Japanese person, and one Brazilian, in the period until the end of puberty or the end of adolescence, this period, this critical period, this child will learn three languages in a perfect way. Okay? It's very important, this period, because the generative is, because the children has a time to acquire language very easy. Okay? In a very simple way.
You are going to see my student.
Good. Yeah. I'm glad to. Okay? So we are talking about generativism, okay? No traumas can do abilities to acquire language. Okay. Let's go. So since 1957, Noam Chomsky has written a book destroying a very strong theory, very strong previous theory, that was the behaviorism. Have you heard something about Skinner, B.F. Skinner, okay? If you have the psychologist subject, probably Sandra Spinola has, or Thiago Gil has spoken something about it. Okay, so the generativism is a theory based on mathematics model that tries to explain abstractly the human language. It's something like you put the language in a microscope, okay, and try to understand language like math or physics, something like that, in a very abstract way. Okay, and they use Chomsky. Use these models. In Portuguese we call diagrama arbóreo. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so we are going to use some diagrams like that too. But not today, okay? Tonight we are going to study only something about theories. Okay. This is Noam Chomsky, he is alive yet. Okay. But let's see something about the behaviorism before generativism, okay? The behaviorism is a theory where B.F. Skinner or a Russian scientist like Pavlov believe that all the animals learn through practice, through repetition, okay? And they compare the animal's learning to the human being learning. So for Skinner, for the behaviorism is like comportamento in Portuguese, okay? So we learn through experiences with the exterior world, with the exterior experiences, okay? And this is one of his experiments. It's called like Skinner box. Okay? He used sometimes rats, sometimes pigeons, okay, to try to teach and observe the reaction of these animals. In this box, Skinner created two buttons with different colors, or sometimes with different words, letters, to make the distinction. In this case, green and red. When the rat touched the green button, it receives some food, okay? It's a positive condition, okay? It's a positive stimulus, okay? But when the rat press or touch the red button, the rat receives some electric shock. It's a negative condition or a negative stimulus. So, observing this behavior, Skinner, let's see. Skinner has understood that the animals learn very quickly these things. So it was more common to press the green button than the red button, because in the green button it receives a positive stimulus. Okay. Another experience was Pavlov's dogs. Dog, okay? In this experience, if you have any animal at home, it's easy to understand. Because when it's time to feed your animal, your dog or your cat, and when you take the food there, or don't make any noise, the cat or the dog quickly identify that it's time to eat something. And these animals salivate a lot, okay? Mainly the dogs. And Pavlov had a dog that had a problem in its mouth, okay? It has a scarf that didn't have any cure. So when the dog salivates, it lost a lot of saliva. Okay, and he could capture this liquid and to measure the quantity. Okay, so using this dog with this problem, he put first food, and the dog lost a lot of salivation. After in another day, before to give the food, he bells a ring as a stimulus, so the dog, unconscious, is going to understand that the sign represents food. In another week, another day, Pavlov's only ring the bell without any food, and the dog salivates a lot too. It's very interesting because it's something uncommon. It's like when you, I don't remember how to say moseja. Se eu não seja aqui, é
inconstante.
Ion.
Ion?
Ion. Ion. Okay, if I yawn, you yawn too. Yes. You can't control. It's something like that, okay? So, using those informations, these authors create this theory. And they compare those reactions to human behavior. And they believe that for human beings learn through repetitions, like a dog, okay, like a rat, like a pigeon. Okay? So if you want to teach something for a human being, you have to repeat and over and over and over again until that person learns. Okay? In part, I agree. In the beginning of our life, when we are a baby, it's important to repetition because we don't have any input. So we have to have some contact with that stereo. But Chomsky is going to say that repetition is important, but the ability of language is innate. Okay? We inherit, nós herdamos, okay? This ability. It's in our mind. So it's a device, some equipment in our brain that is activated with the exterior input. So it's not a question only to make repetitions and learn to fill an empty space. Skinner has a lot of space, huh? in his head. Would you like to say something?
The question is the disposition that aquisition is positive.
Yes, exactly that. Okay, so we have some device, dispositive, in our brain that is stored there. But when you have some contact with, when we are babies, our parents, mother and father says, oh, good morning, little baby. All of these are stimuli. Okay.
What's the name of the device in acquisition?
Acquisition device. Yes, acquisition device. Okay. Noam Chomsky defends that.
Okay,
yeah,
we talked about
that with Thiago. Yeah, Thiago's class are awesome because you can have this previous contact. Okay, mm-hmm. Good. Okay, here is another important guy. He totally believes with Chomsky, but his theory treats human language acquisition as an instinct. Okay. So, he says that a person like a spider, anyone or anything teaches a spider how to create a spider web. And it's very perfect. it's a case of instinct. If you have cats at home, o gato não faz cocôzinho dele lá, ninguém ensina ele tem cobrir, mas todo gato cobre, né? Se você joga um gato ou um cachorro numa piscina, ele vai saber nadar, ninguém ensina. É instinto. So, Pinker says that humans have this instinctive of language. It's a case of instinct. It's impossible to live without communicate for us. If you have some contact with language, our language device is activated. So we start to acquire language. Okay? And if you have some contact and some inputs in a critical period, as I told you, from the birth until the end of adolescence, okay, you can acquire more than one language. For example, if you have...
called the critical period?
Yes, exactly that. The critical period. It's a period where our brain is opened, is amped to be full of language.
They say it's like a sponge.
Yes.
All information it can get.
Yes, exactly that. Absorb a lot of information, okay? Including language, natural. But after this period, we lost this ability. And the area of the brain that acquires language as a sponge is not available anymore. So we have to learn, not acquire more. We lost the ability to acquire language after the adolescence. And we have to learn language. It's a process similar to study mathematics, for example. It's very hard. Because of that, it's so difficult to acquire or learn a language in an adult phase, adult stages. Okay? Okay, let's discuss the language faculty. Let's discuss about the creativity principle too. Principle tá errado ali, né? Tem um LE no final, né? Foi a influência da língua materna ali. Para descrever o slide. Ok.
Creativity,
processo
mesmo, principle.
Principle é com LE, né?
Princípio.
Mas
em que sentido?
É... princípio.
Ah,
né?
Ah, tá.
É. Princípio ou outra coisa, mas não. Não. Foi. Não atentei, escrevi errado.
Ah, princípio, né?
Yes. Ok, imagine a baby. Ok? And we have one example of this blue cat. Or a simple cat. If I have a baby, a child, a son, and I tell to my son, Tom is a cat. Tom is a cat. I'm giving some stimulus. Okay, I'm giving some input, and he's receiving this input. And Chomsky says that a human being have a very amazing ability to change this structure and create new sentences alone, independently. Okay? So in this case, Chomsky destroyed the behaviorism theory because it's not a question to teach the baby all the sentences possible in a language. Okay? To behaviorism, a baby only is going to learn sentences that it has to listen to. Okay? Yes, but it would be impossible to teach all the sentences possible in a language, okay? So Chomsky says that no, the baby is necessary only to have simple input. Using this input, he is able, in a creativity way, to create new sentences, new possibilities. Okay, like the cat is Tom is the cat, or more bigger sentences, like the cat calls. So this is the creativity principle. Sometimes, for a person who has babies in your family, sometimes we get some surprise when a child says something strange or something strong.
You.
Yeah? And you ask, oh, who taught him or her that? It was not me, yeah? It's strange, something other. It was a ghost, or only the TV set, okay? Yeah, but it's the principle.
It's more likely the TV.
Yeah, it's a big possibility, okay? So the baby sometimes listens some few stimulus and creates its own possible sentences, okay, structure. this is interesting, but it's not the most interesting. The most interesting is that the baby has, with this acquisition device, one organization, his own or her own grammar. Okay? The baby.
Inner grammar.
Right? Yes, inner grammar. Né? Gramática na interna, né? Yes. Okay, the baby didn't say something like that. Okay, out of order. Out, get, privacy, some, me, I. The sentence is completely wrong. Okay, we have no meaning here. But the baby says, get up, get out, I need some privacy. Sai fora, preciso de privacidade. Mas o menino de hoje fala tudo, né? Sabe tudo. Okay? So, we call this like universal grammar. It's one organization, it's one, some syntax in our brain before you go to school. So anyone teaches a baby to organize the sentence, to put a noun after a verb, okay, in the correct way. It's natural, it's a biological condition. Okay. Here is just one demonstration of the models, you know, in Portuguese, yes. But we are going to make some adaptations to English. In Portuguese we have syntagmas, syntagmas nominal, né? Usually articles plus nouns, okay, determiner, yes, nouns, verbs. But in English we are going to say phrase. Syntagma in English is phrase, okay? That is the same thing of phrase. So we are going to substitute, to change SN to NP, noun, phrase, as nominal. And syntagma verbal, right, verbal phrase, okay? Some adaptations to English as we are studying English syntax. So, only a demonstration of the model. We're going to study this.
É como se estivesse
na cabeça da criança, né? Yes. Yes. We are studying the mathematical model, trying to explain this organization. But all of this is natural in the baby. Okay? 2-3 years. He or she has all of this into the baby, into it, and they use it, this naturally, in a perfect way. Okay? They don't make any mistake in the position of the structure. Okay, let's talk about some concepts of grammar. We have seen something about universal grammar. Okay, it's a condition. Okay, a condition that we have the inner syntax in our brain. But do you know the definition of traditional grammar? What traditional grammar is for you? Could you explain it? Give a simple explanation.
The set of rules, like we have to follow,
yes,
in order to write, to speak.
Yes, yes, exactly that. So usually we have big books with a set of rules we have to follow in the formal language. Okay. Traditional grammar is totally different of universal grammar. Universal grammar is something natural. Okay. In traditional grammar are a set of words, a set of rules that some grammarian and linguistics choice to be the pattern or the standard of the language, okay? But the traditional grammar has some problems, because sometimes the traditional grammars are not enough to explain some cases in language, okay? And we are going to see some examples. So, traditional grammar is a static system of rules that does not represent the total complexity of language representations. It's important to write some law documents when you buy a house. So, in that scripture, I don't know if it's scripture, that document you have to specify in a very formal way, because it's your money that is in question. So, the language should be precise, okay? But traditional grammar is not enough to explain the complexity of language, the natural languages. Let's see some examples in Portuguese, using the Portuguese pattern, okay? I took some examples from this book, it's awesome. Monóxido, depois if you want, you can take two zeros. It's in Portuguese, but it's a support for our discipline too. It's very good. Let's analyze the adverb definition. Okay? To Celso Cunha, an important grammarian from Portuguese, adverb is, let's see in Portuguese now. Adverbo é, ou são essas palavras que se juntam a verbos para exprimir circunstâncias em que se desenvolve o processo verbal. Né? E adjetivos para intensificar uma qualidade chamam-se adverbos. Então, a gente aprendeu na escola do passado que adverbo é aquele que se junta ao verbo ou adjetivo para modificar ou para influenciar aquele verbo ou aquele adjetivo, né? A grosso modo. Ok, vamos pegar essa definição e vamos ver como ela não é totalmente fiel, né, ao uso geral da língua. Por exemplo, we have these four conditions. A. Provavelmente o João doou os jornais para a biblioteca. No caso, seria o João, não a Maria, né? B. O João provavelmente doou os jornais para a biblioteca. Então ele doou, ele não fez outra coisa, ele não vendeu, por exemplo. C. O João doou provavelmente os jornais, você revistou, você fitas, DVDs, né? Para a biblioteca. E D. O João doou os jornais provavelmente para a biblioteca. Então, o adverbio seria provavelmente, né? Ele estaria influenciando aí. But the problem is, the adverb here, it's not only influencing a verb or an adjective. It could be influencing some different things, like
a noun,
a determiner. So, the traditional grammar fails in this question. It's just one of amount of questions, okay? One interesting thing is that the adverb here is modifying different constituents, not only verb or adjective, as the traditional grammar keeps. Okay, I need the demonstration. Another question is the use of the pronouns, subject pronouns, to